Hello back everyone, now on the correct timetable, I hope. So our next speaker is Robert Cardona from Universitat Politècnica de Catalunya, and he'll be speaking us about integral systems on singular symplectic manifolds.
Okay, so let me try to share screen.
Okay.
Can you see this?
Yeah, perfectly.
Okay, so full screen. Okay, so shall I start?
Yeah, yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so, well, hi everybody. And let me first thank the organizers for inviting me to this conference and allowing me to speak here. So I will be speaking about integrable systems on what I call here singular symplectic manifolds. And this will essentially refer to bisymplectic or folded symplectic manifolds, which are two different kinds of singular symplectic manifolds. And this is based on a joint work with my former PhD advisor, Eva Miranda. And well, the title of the paper is Integrable Systems on Singular Symplectic Manifolds from Local to Global. So let me first recall that, well, indeed, a two-form is symplectic when it's closed and not degenerate, and locally it always looks the same. This is Darboux theorem. And something which is a bit better than Darboux theorem is that you can prescribe a set of functions, let's say up to n functions, which pass on commute and are independent at some point. Then you can fix them into some Darboux-like coordinates. And then this is what's known as the Darboux-Karateodori theorem. An integrable system, we have been speaking about it in this conference. It's just a set of n functions which are functionally independent on a dense set of your manifold and which pass on commute. A classical theorem is that near a regular fiber, you have a trivial fibration, and each regular level set is just a torus. This is Liouville theorem. So let me first introduce bisymplectic geometry. I won't be speaking too much about it today because I will focus on folded symplectic manifolds, but I think it's nice to speak first about this case, and also Eva Miranda will speak about it in her talk, I think. So a symplectic form can be interpreted as a Poisson, so it's just a particular case of a Poisson manifold. And so the two form, you can dualize it and watch it as a Poisson by vector field, in which case it is of maximal constant rank. So this natural generalization, which is just looking at Poisson by vector fields, and then you can have it which are not of maximal rank or which degenerate in different ways, no? And an example, which is probably the best possible singularity, it's just asking that the top wedge product of your bivector field is transverse to the zero section. In this case, we speak of a B-Poisson bivector field or a B-Poisson structure. And in this case, it follows from this transversality that there is an hypersurface that I will denote Z, which is the zero locus or the critical locus, where this bivector field to the end vanishes, and the rank of the Poisson bivector field drops to 2n minus 2.
Please, Eva, mute yourself because there's some noise.
Well, should I continue or?
Yeah, I think we can more or less.
Okay, that's it. Okay, so for these P Poisson manifolds, there is also some kind of Darboux theorem. This is due to Guillemin, Miranda, and Pires. And so this is the normal form, which is very, very much what you would expect. And what's very nice about these B-Poisson manifolds is that they can be, well, there's a very nice framework, which was also introduced by Guillemin, Miranda, and Pires in 2014, which tells you that instead of working with a Poisson bivector field, you can, in fact, look at it as a symplectic form on a tangent bundle, so in a bundle which is not exactly the tangent bundle, but a different one, which is called the B tangent bundle. This is the superscript B here. And this is defined exactly by the bundle, which is generated by, so whose sections are given by vector fields tangent to the given hypersurface Z. So if you give me a pair M, Z, you have this B tangent bundle defined on it. And if you can find, in this B tangent bundle, there is also the dual, which is the B cotangent bundle, where you have a very nice defined Terram differential form, the Terram differential. And so you can define what's called a symplectic form in this context. Right? This is what I will call a B symplectic form, which is a two form non-degenerate, which is closed using this Terram differential in the B cotangent bundle. This two form locally looks like this. So it seems like it has a singularity and it's not smooth, but it is smooth because the thing is that in this B cotangent bundle, this 1 over x1 dx1 is smooth. It's like a section. So this allows us to work, let's say, for some class of Poisson manifolds using techniques from symplectic geometry. Well, not all of them, but some of them can be adapted to this B symplectic case. For instance, Moser's path method, which is one way to prove this local normal form. Let me now speak a bit about action angle coordinates. So the classical Arnold-Liouville-Miner theorem can also be interpreted, if you want, like, which is telling you that near a regular fiber of your integrable system, there is this is equivalent to a cotangent lift of the standard torus action. No? So you have the neighborhood, which is isomorphic to T star of Tn. And the two form can be written in this very nice way, and your integrable system or just the action coordinates in the fibers. In the B symplectic case, you need to extend your set of functions, because if you only consider smooth functions, then in the critical locus in Z, since the Poisson bivector field has rank 2n-2, you can only have up to n minus one independent Hamiltonian vector fields which commute. So what you need to do, and this is very natural, you add some functions to your smooth functions, which are called B functions, which are functions that locally, if you want, close to Z, they look like this. So a constant times logarithm of a defining function of Z. So this function T will be a function which locally identifies Z as T equals zero, plus any smooth function. So if you extend this set of functions, then you get some new Hamiltonian vector fields which can be generated by the Poisson by vector field. And then Kiesenhofer, Miranda, and Scott introduced the notion of B-integrable system and proved an action angle coordinate theorem. Also, Kiesenhofer and Miranda were the ones who identified this as a cotangent model. This will come up later because it's interesting in the folded case what happens. So in this B case, again, the neighborhood of a torus which lies in Z, so in the critical locus, is like the what's called the twisted B cotangent leaf. And then your omega looks like this, which is also like a Darboux-like form. And your integrable system looks like this, where notice that the first one is singular, but because it lives in, it's like a genuine B function, it's not smooth. And the other ones are the typical action coordinates. So let us now address the folded symplectic case. In this case, it's not no longer a Poisson structure, it's a two form, which is closed. And we also ask for this transversality condition, but now we are asking it on two form, no, not on the bivector field. And this transversality does not imply that the rank is 2n-2 in the critical locus. You need to impose it. This is our assumptions. I do not diversify too much the notation. Z will denote again the critical locus, which is an hypersurface, which might be non-connected or whatever. So there's again a very nice Darboux theorem, which is due to Martinet. This is again what you would expect. You have a zero in the coordinate which defines Z, And there is two very nice sub-bundles which are defined over this hypersurface, which will be important, which is, I will denote them by V, which is simply the kernel of the two form along Z. Since the rank is 2n minus 2, this is a bundle of rank 2. And then there's the null line bundle, which is a line bundle defined on Z, which is just the kernel that's restricted to the tangent planes on Z. So let me just mention a few works on this folded symplectic manifold. So, for instance, Canas da Silva, Guillemin, and Woodward in 2000. As far as I know, is one of the first papers where they work on the global geometry of these folded symplectic manifolds. They generalize Moser's path method in this context and explain some folding construction in which you can break your folded symplectic manifold into symplectic pieces which might or might not have boundary. Then in 2010, there was this very nice theorem by Canas da Silva, where she proves an existence-based principle for folded symplectic. And this is very interesting because this does not hold in the symplectic case. And this tells you, so a particular instance of this existence-based principle is that every form manifold is folded, something which is, of course, not the case in the symplectic context. So as you might expect, one of the first generalizations that were done in folded symplectic geometry were those of toric actions. And in 2011, again, Anna Canas da Silva, Guillemin and Pires, they classified toric folded symplectic manifolds with a simplification, say an assumption, which is that this line bundle, which is defined on Z, is an S1 vibration. So this is a very natural assumption if you're studying those actions, of course. And in a PhD thesis by Hawk and Smith in 2015, this classification was generalized without this assumption, let's say. So in this simplifying assumption that I was telling you, which is that the null line bundle defines an S1 vibration in the critical locus in Z. In this case, you call the folded symplectic form an origami form. And this is especially nice because then the classification of toric actions, let's say it's graphically very nice because it's just given by fold. Well, this is what they call origami templates, which are given by a set of dels and polytopes and some ways of folding them. So this will be an example of one moment map of your toric action in a folded symplectic form, in a folded symplectic manifold. So what's not defined yet, so this is done in the BE symplectic case, but not in the folded case, which is simply introducing Hamiltonian dynamics in a much general sense. No? So a natural generalization of these toric actions that are already classified would be some kind of integrable system notion in this folded symplectic case. So the main problem, and this was not happening in the B-symplectic case, is that not every function defines a Hamiltonian vector field. The good thing is that it's rather easy to characterize those functions that define a Hamiltonian vector field, and this is what we will call, of course, folded functions. So this characterization is just in terms of this bundle V, so this sub-bundle that is given by the kernel of omega along your hypersurface. So a function defines a smooth Hamiltonian vector field if and only if the differential of this function vanishes along any section of this bundle V. A particularity of Hamiltonian vector fields on folded symplectic manifolds is that the vector field is always tangent to the hypersurface, to Z. Then we can come up with a very natural definition of folded symplectic, folded integral system, which is asking for an N, so half the dimension of folded functions, so functions which by assumption define smooth Hamiltonian vector fields, which commute with respect to omega. Recall that a priori you don't have any more a Poisson structure, but you can still ask that omega evaluated at any pair of Hamiltonian vector fields is zero, and that the distribution given by these Hamiltonian vector fields is of maximal rank at least on a dense set of M and of Z. So asking that this maximal rank is also true in a dense set of Z, this is just to avoid trivialities, because then you could have essentially an integrable system in the symplectic parts of the manifold, and then there's nothing interesting happening. So one observation is that even if this two form is of rank 2n-2, so there's like a pre-symplectic form of rank 2n-2 on Z, on the high-pressure phase, you can still have an independent Hamiltonian vector fields. And this is, well, let's look at an example of why this can happen. So if you look at the sphere, the two-sphere, with this folded symplectic form, so H is the height function. And then you look, for example, the first example is F equals H squared. So if you compute the Hamiltonian vector field of this function, it's just the rotation in the sphere. It's this X sub F. So notice that along the equator, which is the critical locus, we have a non-vanishing vector field, even though the rank of the two form is zero. And also another peculiarity, which is somehow, not expected, but let's say it does not happen in the symplectic case, is that the differential of this function vanishes along Z, but still defines a non-vanishing vector field, something which is never happens in the symplectic case. So here's another example, G equals H squared cosine of theta, because in this case, well, the only difference is that on Z, you no longer have the whole, the whole rotation generated. You have some singular points, so you can have some singularities in Z. And this is different from the bisymplectic case. So in the bisymplectic case, you can never have a singularity of maximal corank in the hypersurface. So this further motivates studying these folded integrable systems. So one of the main theorems of our work is that there's an action angle coordinate, which you can prove in this context, but there's some, we'll see that there's some differences with the other action angle coordinates. So you can find, of course, a neighborhood, which is a trivial vibration by invariant Torai, and you can find some folded functions, P sub I, which play the role of action coordinates, such that the two form looks like this. And you might say, okay, this looks like it's symplectic, but it's not, because these P sub I are not coordinates. So the coordinates are this T, B2, Bn, which are coordinates on the base. And this P sub I depend on them, so that they depend also on the initial integrals, but they are not coordinates, because you might have, if you want to have an intuition of what's going on, you might have a function which is T squared, in which case it's not a coordinate, but still defines a non-vanishing vector field. So this is what's happening. So somebody could say that this is not good enough because it doesn't look like something like a cotangent model. So let's say when we first started working on this, we expected to prove something like this, so that you could really simplify the normal form, obtain a Martinet-like form, so a Darboux-like form, and then you can assume that the first function is the one which is somehow singular and the other ones are not. But this is not the case, as we will see. So this, let me put this as a proposition. So this previous for normal form cannot be achieved in general. Under other assumptions, yes, but not in general. And in fact, what you can do is to construct examples of folded integrable systems where for any regular fiber that you pick, there is no such nice normal form. Let me first give a little sketch of how to prove this action angle coordinates theorem for folded symplectic manifolds. So we first start by the topological aspect, which is Liouville's theorem. And to do this, we adapt the argument which was given for Poisson integrable systems in a paper by Miranda and Heike and Laurent Jean-Joux, I think. And then the key step, to adapt this argument is that you need to check that the null bundle which is this rank one bundle generated along the hypersurface, is always generated in a neighborhood of a regular fiber. Of course, I'm assuming that my regular fiber lies on the critical locus because away from it, it's just a symplectic manifold. So you can apply the standard theorem. Then we need to generalize this Darboux-Karatéoli theorem for symplectic manifolds to the folded symplectic case. In this case, you need, of course, to assume that the n functions that you are trying to prescribe in your Darboux-like form are folded functions. So we are assuming that they define smooth Hamiltonian vector fields. And then you can, well, I haven't written the statement because it's just what you would expect. Then we use an equivariant relative Poincaré lemma near the torus to find some primitive of the two form, which is invariant by the torus action. Then we do the classical uniformization of periods at a distermat and use the exactness to find some n-folded functions, which are, let's say, the candidates and which are equivariantly defined to be the action coordinates. To conclude, although I already told you that omega is not Poisson, the good thing is that the set of folded functions have some well-defined Poisson bracket, just let's say by definition. And then we, using this fact and the joint flow, you basically extend the candidates to be the action coordinate and their S1 valued conjugate coordinates to the whole neighborhood. And like this, you prove the action angle coordinate theorem that I stated before. So let me now try to justify why the action angle coordinates cannot be improved to find something like this. This is this proposition, if you want. So let me assume it. So assume that I found near a regular fiber of my folded integrable system a neighborhood with this very nice cotangent model somehow. So what you can see is that the null bundle in this very explicit coordinates is just given by the first Hamiltonian vector field. So a corollary is that near that regular fiber, the null bundle is an S1 vibration. So all the orbits are closed, for example. If you want to think in terms of orbits, you have that all the characteristics are closed, at least in a neighborhood of the regular fiber. So now we will use this fact to show that there are examples where this is not possible. So I will construct a very explicit example of a folded symplectic manifold with a folded integral system in which the previous observation cannot happen. So start by considering on the sphere an irrational pseudo-rotation. So this is it's a symplectomorphism. In fact, this is the important part. A symplectomorphism of the sphere, which has only two periodic points in the north and the south pole. All the other points are not periodic. Then we consider the associated mapping torus. So we consider S2 times 0, 1 and identify the S2 times 0 with S2 times 1 by the map. And this is endowed with what is called a cosymplectic structure. If you want, this is a symplectic foliation of core rank 1. So you have a one form alpha, which defines the foliation, which is just the one form defined by the differential of this coordinate in 0, 1, quotiented. And then this omega tilde is just the form that you obtain by gluing the standard symplectic form on S2 with its pullback by phi. Because it's a symplectomorphism, this glues well and gives you a two form, which is closed of rank 2 in S2 times S1. This is the manifold that you get by the mapping torus. Then we multiply again by S1, the resulting manifold, which is a four manifold. And this can be endowed with a very easy example of a folded symplectic form, which is just picking theta to be the coordinate of this last component. And then you pick sinus of theta, d theta wedge, the one form of the cosymplectic structure, plus tilde omega. So this sine of theta vanishes transversally two points. So we have two copies of critical locus Z, which is S2 times S1 times 0, and S2 times S1 times pi. What you can check immediately is that the null bundle, this null line bundle that we have been speaking about in this critical surface, hypersurface Z, is given by the kernel of omega, and the kernel of omega tilde, sorry, omega tilde, the kernel of omega tilde is just the vector field obtained by the suspension of our pseudo rotation. So a property that this null bundle has is that it only has two closed characteristics, which are the north pole and the south pole suspended. So in particular, any folded integrable system that you can define in this manifold cannot admit this local normal form, because if you have a local normal form, which is this cotangent-like cotangent model, let's say, you would have infinitely many orbits of the null bundle which are closed. And since there's only two of them, this cannot happen. Okay, then something else that could happen is that in this example, there is no folded integrable system defined on this manifold, but this is not the case. So it's very easy to check that this pair defines a folded integrable system. Indeed, this cosine of theta is a function which vanishes quadratically. So it acts like t squared in our example that we showed a few slides before. Okay, so well, let me just finish by mentioning other things that we have investigated in our work on singular symplectic manifolds, but I won't be able to tell you anything more than the statements because I'm almost done. So a first theorem that we established, and which is just the first steps into some, let's say, global aspects of B integrable systems. So in the B case, there's already proof, the action angle coordinate theorem is proved. But what's not obvious is that every B symplectic manifold admits a B integrable system. So in the symplectic case, this is true. This was proven, as far as I know, by Barilov, that every symplectic manifold admits an integrable system. It's a very trivial system, which is just given in some dark walls covering and so on. No? But in the bisymplectic case, the proof does not work because there is a whole invariance thing. So we investigated this with Eva and proved that at least with some assumption on the critical set, you can construct, let's say, non-trivial, in this case, non-trivial integrable systems near Z and then extend it away from Z. And this same construction allows us to investigate obstructions to finding global or even semi-global. By semi-global, I mean near Z action angle coordinates. So we can construct bisymplectic structures and also folded symplectic structures by some desingularization procedure, where any integrable system that you can find in these manifolds do not admit action angle coordinates semi-globally, near Z. And this is because there's a topological obstruction which lies in the singular locus, and it's a topological one. It does not even depend on the integrable system. So that will be everything I have to say, and thanks a lot.
Thanks, Robert, for that talk. It was really nice. Does anyone have any question?
Yes. Yes, this was done by, well, was done. I mean, the construction is very similar to the B tangent bundle. It's not exactly dual, and you can do it. So Hockensmith did it in his PhD thesis. You can use this folded tangent bundle to construct examples of folded integrable systems via cotangent lift and so on. But let's say the theory is not so rich as in the bisymplectic case, mainly because in the folded cotangent bundle, there is no differential. There is no well-defined differential. So there is no Ramcohomology and so on.